We are now recording and let me introduce. Hi, good evening everyone. Today is our 15th webinar, Natural Ecology Group 15th webinar on how to start vegetable gardening and terrace and how to grow our own food. And today we have a presenter from Marali Mannighe, Back to Soil team. And Shubha Govindachar is going to give her experiences on how to start terrace gardening, what are the ways to implement and what are the challenges we'll face and all the stuff. And telling about, a brief introduction about her. The Back to Soil team consists of Shubha Govindachar, Bharati Ashwarth and Priya Srinivasanji. And all of them grow vegetables at home as a hobby. And they started as a hobby. And in the due course, they learned on how to do composting and reduce the landfill and how to use the wet waste generated at home. And then slowly, they got the experiences and they started conducting workshops on OFIT events at different places and composting process. And then they moved to the digital platform to reach out to those who could not attend the events. And one more thing is they started the WhatsApp sessions. That means every month they will send out a link on their Facebook page and in the different groups. And once it fills, then they are during the cutoff time, after the cutoff time, they will start sharing the interactive discussions in the WhatsApp. And good thing is they are doing that like that from the past couple of years. And whoever's in the natural ecology groups, you already saw many such invites and they have completed vegetable gardening and compost. And hats off to their work, and they're doing all these things without any expectations and with a lot of dedication and a lot of patience. You know, nowadays, handling a WhatsApp group itself is a big challenge now, but they're doing that every month. That's very, very nice of them. And along with the interactive discussions, they also present some of the videos and PDF files to have a look and feel. And then coming to the background, they worked as a senior engineering manager in an IT company, and gardening is their hobby, and mostly to generate chemical-free food and also to reduce the landfill through composting. With this, I'll complete the introduction of the presenter. Shubhaji, all over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sudhir. I will share my presentation now. Okay, I guess I can't share while you are sharing.
Now you can share.
Okay. Okay. So, thank you, Sudhir. This is a great opportunity for me to share some of my learnings. Hello, everyone. Good evening. So, my journey in organic terrace gardening started a few years back. It really took off after I attended a one-day workshop by Dr. Vishwanath and Dr. Rajendra Hegde here in Bangalore. I've also attended a terrace gardening session at Lal Bagh again in Bangalore. So today I will try to give you an overall picture on what is involved in developing an organic terrace garden, primarily to grow vegetables. So at the outset, what is so different about growing vegetables? Most of us are familiar with growing ornamentals and flowering plants at home. These plants do not need a lot of care. Perhaps a repot once a year, addition of manure once in 6 months or so, and some pruning now and then. So, and then they are happy to flower and grow. Vegetable plants are a different ball game altogether. For one, their life cycle is very short, a few months. So every few months you need to grow a new vegetable. So repotting and regenerating, re-sowing the seeds, making saplings, all this happens every few months. Vegetable plants are also prone to pest attacks, and they also need nutrition ever so often. So there is a need to tend to these plants almost every week. Of course, every day you need to water them and look at them. But you also need to do a few things repeatedly, once in a week or once in 2 weeks. So let's get started then. Why OTG? So at the outset, what is OTG? OTG stands for Organic Terrace Garden. Ground space being a premium these days, most of us grow vegetables in balcony or terraces where there is abundant exposure to sunlight. Most of the vegetables from the market would have been subjected to chemical fertilizers or pesticides. And over time, this can cause diseases in us. You know, all of us know cancer is due to chemical exposure. Homegrown vegetables provide us with a constant supply of chemical-free vegetables. In my home, the vegetables I grow, I can easily cover 3 to 4 days a week. Perhaps the remaining 2 days I need to buy something from the market, but at least 3 to 4 days a week, I'm okay with what I have grown at home. It's also an excellent hobby, something to look forward to each morning. It's definitely a source of good exercise, especially you get exposed to sunlight, so vitamin D and so on. We get to make a lot of new friends, share our harvest and seeds and also saplings with them. There are many groups on Facebook and WhatsApp these days. We also can share our harvest with our neighbors, our friends, family and so on. Children at home, you know, a lot of the kids don't know how to grow vegetables. So it's an excellent time to teach them how to grow vegetables and harvest them. So all in all, it's a wonderful hobby to cultivate. So what exactly is needed? You know, like I mentioned, vegetable gardening needs a few hours of your time each day. For one, you need to water them daily. In summer, perhaps you need to water them twice a day. But you also need to look at them and check if they're doing okay, if there's any pest trying to, lodge onto them. So things like that. You need to allocate a few hours of your time each day. Try to get access to a good source of seeds. There are two types of seeds. One is heirloom or what we call nati seeds. Here the quality is consistent, but sometimes the nati seeds can be prone to diseases. So you need to make sure you get a good quality of seeds. Hybrid seeds are a mixed breed, and they generally are more resistant to diseases. They also sometimes, you know, will give you more harvest and probably faster also. So you can try both seeds and see which one you like to work with. Space, I would say look around and see what is available. Some exposure to sunlight is definitely needed. You need at least 3 to 4 hours for vegetable gardening. So balcony, terraces, a small landing on your staircase, all these are good spaces to start keeping your container. But before you do that, make sure you waterproof the area, because you don't want your neighbor to suddenly see water dripping down from the roof. So make sure you waterproof. Another precaution is if you're living in an old building, then make sure the structure is sound. Because, you know, you may start small, you may start with a few pots, but eventually if you expand and have 50 to 100 pots, the building structure should be able to take the load. So just check that out and then then start. And sun, yes, you know, like I've been saying, you need sunlight. Access to water, I would say this is a big yes, because you need to water the plants every day. And if you don't have access to a tap or a hose pipe where the plants are, then chances are you can get lazy and put off watering, which is a no-no. So please make sure you have access to water. And also, too much watering is not good, because the new, you know, it's a container gardening. So in a container gardening, if you add too much water, chances are the nutrients get leached out or depleted. Also, if it's too moist and soggy, then it can breed pests, and the roots can also start to decay. So these are some precautions you need to think of before you start. Nutrition. Just like human beings need carbohydrates, protein, and fat. These are the main macros that we need, along with a lot of micronutrients like calcium, magnesium, zinc, phosphate, and so on. So similarly, plants need nitrogen to generate leaves, greenery. Phosphorus, it helps build the root structure and the, you know, the stem structure above ground. Potassium to generate buds and flowers. And also they need many micronutrients, just like we do. They need calcium, magnesium, iron, chromium, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So that is one basic necessity. That is their food. The potting mix has to be airy, porous, light, and moist. Moist so that it can hold some moisture, or it can hold on to the nutrients that we add to the pot. So generally, we recommend equal quantity of soil, red soil. Cocoa peat is processed coconut fiber. You can't use the coconut fiber directly from the coconut shell. It's a little process, so it holds moisture, and it stays for a while. Compost could be your homemade compost. It could be vermicompost. Also farmyard manure, sheep manure or cow manure, and a few spoons of neem powder, primarily as a pest repellent. If you have old sand or soil, please throw it out, because if you've used chemical fertilizers on them, then it takes at least 5 years to leach out all the chemicals inside it. So it's best to just discard it and start fresh, get fresh new sand, soil. The containers, because we are sitting on top of a building or a balcony, it should be lightweight. Try to be, innovative. Just look around. If you're starting out, I would say, don't right away invest in grow bags and all that. Try to start with what you have in your house, maybe a paint bucket, maybe plastic buckets, your milk covers, or some plastic containers that you've collected in your kitchen. Water bottles are good. So start with anything that looks like it can contain some potting medium. And then once you're comfortable, you can expand and invest in whatever you want to buy. So try to use food grade plastic. HDPE plastic is the material that is normally used for grow bags, because it's resistant to heat and it does not leach chemicals also. So this is just an example. These are pipes, water pipes. So you can use these water pipes to grow plants. You can set them up horizontally or vertically, and it gets depth through the length of the plot of the pipe, and you can pretty much grow any plant in these pipes. This, it's an old bathtub that I have repurposed. You can see brinjals growing here. These are white brinjals. Over here, I have white grow bags, and there's also a terracotta pot here, and this is a black grow bag. This is a plastic pot. So pretty much you can, you know, see what you can find and start using them. Again, this is a bathtub that I have repurposed. You can see these are creeper beans growing here. These are plastic tubs that you can get in any plastic store. These are good for growing greens. Primarily for greens, you need shallow containers, but you need them to be wide because you need a large number of greens at a time. So containers like this, you know, rectangular or square, they are good for growing greens. So we'll start with how to fill a container. So take a container, make a few holes at the bottom. So this is my container here, and I've made some holes, and you can put some pebbles or perhaps, you know, break a coconut shell into small pieces, tiles or clay pot pieces against these holes just to cover them. This is to prevent the potting medium from clogging the holes. You really want the water that you add to seep out through the holes. So the tile pieces will prevent any clogging of the holes. If the pot is a big pot, like greater than 14 inches, I would say the bottom half, you know, maybe 6 to 10 inch, 8 inches, you can add dry leaves, a combination of dry leaves, half-done compost or sugarcane bagasse till half the pot, till about 8 inches of the pot, and then fill the rest with regular potting mix. So as the plant grows, the half-done compost in the bottom will slowly start to decompose and give nutrients to the roots as they come deeper into the container. The potting medium should be equal quantities of red soil, cocoa peat, compost, vermicompost or farmyard manure, like I mentioned earlier, some home-done compost and a handful of neem powder. So if you can see in this photograph here, this is red soil. The redness shows that it has a lot of minerals in them, you know, copper, manganese, and so on. This is cocoa peat, and this is some farmyard manure that I've collected. This is my home-done compost, and this is a packet of neem powder from the market. So just take equal quantities and a little bit of neem powder and mix everything up together in a larger container. And once it's thoroughly mixed, you can fill the container to about 3/4 of its height. You don't have to fill all the way high. The primary reason is when you add water to the container, you don't want the potting medium to splash out. Also, as the plant grows, you will be topping up the medium with fertilizers and so on. So you want to leave some room at the top where you can top up the fertilizer. After you're done filling the potting medium, add water to the container and make sure that water drains out from the bottom. Where the holes have been made, the water should come out. If water comes out, then you know for sure that the drainage is good and you can use this pot for planting your seeds. You can also use sand instead of cocoa peat, but personally I would not recommend because it depletes the riverbed, and you'll also find that sand these days is very expensive. Cocoa peat is readily available and there's plenty of coconut fiber lying around. So I would suggest use cocoa peat instead of sand. Now, so we discussed containers, we discussed potting medium. We also saw how to fill a container. So now we are trying to sow or plant the vegetables. So there are different methods of sowing. The first one is direct sow. So, you know, seeds of radish, beetroot, carrot, leafy greens, beans, etc. These can all be directly sowed into your pot. So once you have your container ready with potting medium and you get the seeds and you start sowing them. After you've sown the seeds, lightly water and keep it in a shade until it starts to sprout. Wait for 2 to 4 leaves to appear. It might take a week to 10 days depending on the seed. Once the leaves appear, then you can bring them out to the sunlight. Now, some seeds you need to plant separately, generate a sapling, and then transplant into your container. So some of these are tomato, brinjal, okra, capsicum in the cauliflower family, the cabbage family. So you can get a seedling tray like this and fill it with cocoa peat, and then these are the seeds here. You can add 1 or 2 seeds into each of these cups of the seedling tray. A few weeks later, you will find the saplings start to grow and they generate 4 to 6 leaves. Once they have 4 to 6 leaves, you can gently remove the sapling and plant them in your container. So once again, you need to lightly water the seedling tray and then keep it in the shade until it starts to sprout. So continuing with the different planting methods from roots. Ginger and turmeric, these are rhizomes. So the mature rhizome needs to be potted. So I would say for ginger, you take a mature rhizome, keep it in water for a couple of days, and you will see that it starts to develop shoots. So once the shoot is developed, you can take the rhizome and put it in your potting medium. Turmeric, similar process, but turmeric is pretty seasonal. End of spring, beginning of summer is when is the right time to sow some turmeric. In Bangalore, around Ugadi, right now is the best time to plant turmeric. So until now, you can keep them in a bag of cocoa peat, and around Ugadi time frame, you'll see the shoots starting to develop. That's when you can take the rhizome and transplant it into your potting medium. Stem cuttings, mint or pudina, Malabar spinach, basle sopu is what we call it. It's also called Ceylon spinach. These are can be propagated through stems. So once you buy something from the market, you can remove the leaves, use them in your kitchen, and then the mature stem, you can place it in water. A few days later, you'll see the roots beginning to develop. You can transplant them into your potting medium. You can also directly plant the stem in the potting medium. It will grow. Mature fruit. So something like chow chow or sime badnekai, it's also called coyote. This has to be planted from a mature fruit. So if you can find a mature fruit from the market, they're really very hard and kind of prickly. And you can also see the tongue coming up through the top of the coyote. So keep it in a bag of cocoa peat. And a few days later, you'll see the leaves starting to develop. Once 4 to 6 leaves develop, you can plant them. I have not been successful growing chow chow in a pot, but some of my friends have successful in growing them in big pots, perhaps 16-20 inch pots, but I have successfully grown them on ground. So you can make space on ground and then lead the plant up to your terrace. That is also good. This is a wonderful plant. It's almost perennial. It will last 2 to 3 years, and fruits are abundant. So now we will talk about the container size. So we saw how to plant and grow. Now we will talk about container size. What is the optimum container size for each vegetable. Small pots, 6 to 8 inches, ideal for greens. And also if you can get a broad one, shallow containers, they're ideal for greens. Coriander, I just need to mention, the coriander seeds should be split open. Just crush them gently with a roller and split open the pod and then plant the pod as is. Medium pots, 12 to 14 inches, this is ideal for most vegetables. Most of the vegetables that we use in the house, from cabbage, carrots, brinjal, they can all be grown in 12 to 14 inch pots. So this is the go-to pot if you're wondering what size to buy. This is the best size to buy. Larger pots, 16 inches, they're good for creepers, ivy gourd, or different types of gourd, squash, cucumber, all of them have a big root system. So they need space in the container. So 16 inches and above is good for them. Fruit, if you're trying to grow fruits, I would say even bigger than 16 inches, perhaps 20, 24 inches would be a good size container to start fruits off. Now, the distance between plants. So you can, choose the container size, but you also need to decide how many plants in each container, because there is a specific distance that you need to maintain between the plants. So for beans, it's about 3 inches between each plant. Beets, 2 to 4 inches. Brinjal, only one per plant, one per pot. Cabbage, definitely one. Green chili, one. Okra, one. So the reason being, most of these are heavy feeders. So the volume of the container is kind of dictates the amount of nutrition they can get in that container. So it's ideal to grow only one plant per pot for these vegetables. And the third column, I've shown the depth to which the seed should be planted. So, for beans, it's about half an inch. Roughly, you can say the size of the seed is the size of the depth that you need to plant it in. That's just a rough measure. You can go with that. So radish, again, you need space for the bulbs to develop underground. So 2 to 4 inches between the seeds. Now watering. Now watering is very crucial. Like I mentioned earlier, overwatering is a no-no. So to start off, it can lead to root rot if you overwater, and also start the breeding of pests. When you have new saplings or seedlings that are just coming up, especially greens, sprinkle water. Don't put water with a hose pipe, because the weight of the water will bend the sapling. So try to sprinkle water over the saplings to just be gentle with them. After heavy rains, yes, watch out for pests. During summer, add a mulch of dry leaves around your plant. So this is how I've shown it. There's a mulch of dry leaves in this container here. This will prevent water evaporation and also save you the second round of watering. Yeah, eventually it will decompose and convert into compost. It will also generate humus for the plant. You can also use a shade net above to prevent water evaporation in summer. Now we come to the organic fertilizers, the nutrition that needs to be given to the plants. So there are several organic nutrients that you can use. Panchagavya, it's you can buy this. You can buy this from gardening stores, or you can make them. There are several recipes available on the net. Basically, it uses cow dung and cow urine, also some yogurt and milk and jaggery. So it's a source of NPK which is needed by the plants, and also because we've added milk and yogurt. It contains lactobacillus. It also, you know, like cow dung is a good source of microorganisms. So it contains a lot of micronutrients and also microorganisms. Generally, the dilution ratio is 3 ml in 1 liter of water. Approximately once a month is the usage. Jivamrita, you can make this at home. Once again, this is made using cow dung and cow urine and also jaggery. So again, 100 ml in 1 liter of water. Compost tea, so for those of us who don't have access to cow dung and cow urine, you can make compost tea. Again, it's a good source of NPK and microorganisms. You don't need to dilute it. You can directly do a foliar spray or add it to the soil. Homemade compost, you know, all the wet waste from your kitchen and the flowers from your puja room and also your garden waste can also be composted. And this contains a lot of nutrition that is good for the plants. Farmyard manure, if you can get access to goat or sheep manure or cow manure, you can make sure it's dried and not fresh. So dried manure is a slow release fertilizer. Again, a good source of NPK and microorganisms. So you can add them once a month or while repotting, that's a good time to add farmyard manure because it's a slow release fertilizer. Okay, so I'll briefly describe how to make Jivamrita. Basically, you need about half a kg of cow dung, half a liter of cow urine, 100 grams of jaggery, 100 grams of basin. This provides, you know, protein for the multiplication to happen. Jaggery gives the sugar and the energy. And a handful of soil. This soil should be rich in microbes. So look for soil that looks healthy, that looks like it has a lot of microorganisms in it, and take a handful of that. So put everything in a bucket and mix everything. Add 10 liters of water and cover it. So every day, 3 to 4 times a day, stir it in one direction. Use a stick, use a wooden stick if possible, and stir it in one direction. And in 2 to 4 days, you will see a lot of froth developing on the top of the bucket. So that's the right time to use it. Don't use it after 10 days because by then most of the microorganisms would have died. So the microorganisms multiply and they're at their peak in number at the end of 3 to 4 days. So once again, the dilution ratio, 1 liter in 10 liters of water. If you're trying to do a foliar spray, please filter. Otherwise, your spray can will get clogged up. This is how to make compost tea. So for those of us who don't have access to cow dung and cow urine, you can take, half a kilo of compost. You can take vermicompost or even your home done compost, some jaggery, and once again, a handful of soil that's rich in microorganisms. You will need an aquarium pump here to kind of, agitate the water. And a bucket of 20 liters of water. So take a socks or a cotton bag and fill it with the soil and compost. Tie the mouth of the bag with a string and dip it in the bucket filled with water and jaggery. Insert the aquarium pump stone into the water and run it for about 72 hours. So it starts to smell good and a lot of froth comes up. If the bag starts to float up, then you might want to add a stone and weigh the bag down so it stays inside the bucket. So you can use this as a foliar spray or you can even water the potting medium. Biofertilizers. These are essentially, microorganisms that enable the nutrients to be made available for the plant for it to absorb. So they improve the soil activity. They also convert and make available plant nutrients, and it also helps the root system to absorb and improves the soil structure and humus. So there are many types of microbes that we normally add. They're rhizobium and azotobacter. Both of these fix nitrogen in the soil. Pseudonymus makes phosphates available to the plant. Trichoderma is actually a fungus, and it helps the root system develop, and it also protects the plant from root rot and wilt and so on. So you can purchase these in gardening stores. And like I mentioned, Panchagavya, Jivamruta, they will all contain a small quantity of these biofertilizers. But when you're repotting or when you think your plants need a boost, then it's good to get this, it's called microbial consortium. You can buy a bag of microbial consortium and add it to all your pots. So once again, best to be added when you initially do the potting mix. So organic pesticide. So now we discussed fertilizers. We also saw how to prepare fertilizers. So now we'll talk about organic pesticides, or I call them pest repellents. So a 3G spray, it's essentially 50 grams or equal quantities of green chili, ginger and garlic. Just grind everything together, make a paste and soak it in water overnight. So it ferments and becomes strong. The next morning you can filter, take about 10 ml in 1 liter water and spray. So wherever you see pests, you can start spraying 3G. Neem oil spray, 10 ml of neem oil. Make sure it's strong. You have to check what the azotobacter strength is in your neem oil. It should be at least 50% or so. And then you add a couple of drops of dish soap or shampoo. This will help the oil to spread throughout the water. And then you can spray. Shikekai, once again, you can take about 50 grams in 1 liter water, filter and spray. Turmeric is also, a pest repellent. 50 grams in 1 liter water, you can filter and spray. Now, the plants can also develop deficiency in nutrients. And this I've taken directly from the web. So by looking at the leaves, you can judge what deficiency they have, whether it's phosphorus or magnesium, if the roots, the leaves are yellow or white with green veins, then it's iron and so on. So this chart kind of explains how to determine what nutrition the plant is deficient in. So my take on this, being layman, I wouldn't try to get this far. I would be proactive and add nutrients every 2 weeks and make sure you add different types of nutrients so it gets all the micronutrients that are needed way in advance. Because it's very hard to, decipher what went wrong later on. Blossom and rot, this is a very common problem in tomatoes. This is primarily due to calcium deficiency. So you can't add calcium the day you see blossom and rot and expect it to correct itself. No, it won't. The best time to add this is when you plant the sapling. So after you plant the sapling, and then every 2 weeks from then on, you need to add a source of calcium. It could be bone meal. It could be chuna, what we use in making paan. You can also use diluted milk. And to enable the absorption of calcium, you need some Epsom salt. Or it's a source of magnesium. So magnesium helps the absorption of calcium. So now we come to diseases. So like us, the plants can also develop various diseases. They could be bacterial, fungal, or viral diseases. So powdery mildew, you know, what you normally see like this, the leaf turns white and powdery. This is a fungal attack. Generally happens after rains or if there's too much moisture. The best way to get rid of this is to, initially if it's just one or two leaves, just pluck the leaves and drop them, or else you can add a spray of diluted milk, 10 ml milk in 1 liter water as a foliar spray. Any bacterial issues, I think neem oil is the best option for bacterial pests. So if you have stunted growth, wilting, drooping of flowers, this is all due to root rot. So the best thing for this is to add some wood ash and turmeric to the containers, or dilute bhaje, which is sweet flag, in 1 liter water and pour it into the potting medium. Trichoderma, one of the microbes that we discussed, addition of that will also help prevent this root rot. Now, viral diseases, mosaic virus or poor qualities, could be due to poor quality seeds. It's very difficult to cure viral diseases. So my first reaction would be, if you see viral diseases, just destroy the plant, or because it can spread from plant to plant. The other, I think that's the best thing to do. You know, if you see something like this, try to break the twig and add some nutrition to the plant. If it still doesn't go away, then I would say just destroy the plant and start fresh. So continuing with pests, this is a ladybird. It's actually a helper. It eats all the aphids and mites that come onto the plants. This is thrips, mealybugs, white aphids, black aphids, and this is leaf miner. Leaf miner is essentially larva of your pest. Just break the leaf and discard it. So initially, when you see any of these pests, you know, aphids or thrips or mites, I would say spray a jet of water and try to dislodge them gently with your hand or a toothbrush, and see if it'll go away. If it still persists and comes back, then I would spray some neem solution or 3G solution to try and ward them off. Leaf miners, I talked about it. Holes in fruits. These are generally caused by fruit flies. They're also called borers. For this, you need to grow trap crops like marigold or some yellow flowering plants, which will attract the fruit flies. You can also use a pheromone trap. The pheromone trap will attract the male fruit fly and prevent the female fruit fly from laying eggs in your fruits. So these are different ways you can attack these fruit flies. Ants, sprinkle turmeric and that should repel the ants. So as a rule, I would say don't try to be a doctor. Don't try to be a doctor and try to determine the nature of the pest or the disease, or look up web to figure out what has happened and all that. The first step, first of all, prevention is better than cure. So add fertilizers every 2 weeks. Keep the plant healthy. If the plant is healthy, then its immune system is strong and it will fight the pests on its own. If, on the other hand, if there is some pest attack or disease, first step is to wash with water and add some nutrition so it can become healthy again. If it still persists, then try to remove the infected leaf or stem, and once again, add some fertilizer to strengthen the plant. If it still persists, then you can go for a neem solution or a 3G solution. as a rule, I think you should cut off old branches. If you see yellow leaves, brown leaves, just remove them right then and there. The older plants are weak and they tend to attract pests. So try to revive with additional fertilizer. If it still looks weak, then I say just remove it and start fresh. So in organic, plant care, it's very difficult to control the disease once it has started. So weekly once spray either 3G or neem solution or diluted milk solution. So every week, I think you should spray some pest repellent, and every 2 weeks add a compost, and 10 days later add a liquid fertilizer, and keep this routine going so that the plant is healthy and strong, and you try to ward off the pest right at the beginning. Because once it comes, then it's very difficult in organic plant care to kill the pest effectively. Yeah, so end of plant life, uproot the plant, and if it doesn't have a lot of diseases, you can add it to your compost bin. I would say leave the pot dry for a couple of days, so don't water it. Alternatively, you could just spread the potting medium out in the sun to solarize it for a couple of days, and then you can regenerate that potting medium by adding new compost, farmyard manure, and neem, and then refill, and then plant a new sapling or new seed in that potting medium. So tips to get maximum yield. The quality of seeds and saplings is very important. Also sowing in the right season. In Bangalore, we are very lucky. We can pretty much grow most of the vegetables all through the year. Otherwise, you can check the sowing calendar for your area and figure out if it's the right time. Like I mentioned earlier, newly planted or transplanted saplings should be kept in the shade for a day until they stabilize. Then you can move them out to the sunlight. The potting medium should be light and airy. Do not overwater, please. Adding nutrients and fertilizer every 15 days is a must. Spray pesticide, I've said if required, but I would say as a preventive, you can just continue to spray some dilute neem or milk and just to ward off pests early enough. Make sure the farmyard manure that you use is mature and it's dry. Plants need support, so I will give you some ideas for support. Infected plants, dead plants, please remove them because they're breeding ground for pests. And once in 6 months, replenish your potting mix, solarize, and then add all the manure again and reuse. Biofertilizers once a year. Basically, healthy plants means the immune system is good and they can fight the diseases themselves. I would say start small. Don't start immediately with 50 pots or 100 pots. Start with 5 pots, maybe 5 tomato pots or 2 tomatoes, 2 chili. And then once you become comfortable, you can add 5 more and then 5 more and then slowly expand your garden. So some support system for the plants. Tomatoes need a mesh like this. So you can place bamboo sticks and then use a wire mesh or a string to create this. You can also use poles so that the creepers can wind themselves around it. Also use a string system like this. Something like this, a terrace can be bought. These are some ideas that you can use to give support for your plants. So crop rotation. Generally, I don't think this is required for container garden, primarily because every 6 months we replenish the potting medium. So, but in ground, if you're planting in the ground, then if you grow the same crop in the same spot every time, nutrients tend to get depleted, and it will also get prone to pest attack. So best is to follow crop rotation. So generally some root, then a fruit, then leaf and a legume plant. So if you rotate the vegetables, then the system remains healthy. So grow what you can use in your kitchen. Plan your harvest so often, so at regular intervals, so that you have continuous harvest. I would say figure out what vegetables you use in your kitchen, what your family needs, and just grow those vegetables. And so every so often, so that you have a continuous stream. So I'm not sure if I have time. Perhaps not. It's already. So in the end, gardening is a vast subject. Not everything can be taught. So start growing and learn from experience. Start small, plan, and grow what your family needs. Get your hands dirty. Be patient. This is the only way to learn. Good luck to all.
Yeah, thank you, Shubhaji, for your detailed guidance and sharing your experiences. So really, it's very helpful. Yeah, and again, yes, Shubhaji said, is not easy to complete all the question and answers. So, but in the NELG groups, I'm going to share a couple of videos and playlist what I have and the formula what I described. And during the session, we can observe that all the details of the formula are covered in their speech. Yeah. And yeah. Thank you. Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, with this, we'll conclude today's webinar. Thanks to Back to Soil team, Shubhaji and Bharatiji and Priya Srinivasanji. And thank you for all for joining this today's webinar.
Yeah, I'm sorry I took so much time. No time for questions, but we can take some tomorrow if needed.
Yeah, and again, tomorrow we are going to have a same session on the composting. Why to compost?
Hello. Sudhir.
Yeah. I am audible now.
Yeah.
Okay. 1 second. Tomorrow at the same time, we'll be having the webinar and we'll conclude this today. Yeah. Thank you all.
Thank you.